The fundamental elements of music are pitch, duration, timbre, such as trumpet versus clarinet, and dynamics. Some authors add frequency and texture to the mix. Well, that's a load of musical jargon. You might ask, are we going to learn that? And yes, we are. So I am going to guide you through this as best I can and make this a painless learning process, which it will be. Before I begin on Lesson 2 of the Piano Lessons 1 through 3 lecture series, I'd like to introduce you to a few things. First of all, if you're watching this series, you're likely trying to learn something about music theory or piano. In doing such, you should be taking notes, unless you have an eidetic memory, in which case, good for you. However, most people do not, I do not. So if you would like to take notes, I highly recommend you get yourself some of this. This is called manuscript paper. It is simply blank staves that you can fill in with the notes you want to take. You can go online and search for PDF versions of manuscript paper and print it out, or you can get some from a music store or online. Either way, it will make your life many, many times easier, as opposed to myself drawing them out. Good thing to have. Next, as you might notice, we have a metronome. This is what a metronome is. It is simply a device that we use to create a steady beat when we're playing. That's pretty slow. I believe it's set somewhere around 60 beats per minute. Anyways, you'll want one of these. You can order these online. You can also go to a music store, get them for $10 to $20. You'll need this. You need to play with a steady beat. It's as important as in the beginning as it is later on. So also look into getting a metronome. It doesn't matter what style, as long as you have one of these. Next, if you're trying to learn piano, in addition to music theory, you should have a lesson book. Up here I have one example of what a lesson book is. A lesson book simply contains songs from front to back that gradually increase in difficulty and introduce you to new musical terms. Now, as I mentioned in Lesson 1, the easy songs will have these numbers below them, which allow you, I will show this again when I'm at the piano so you have a closer view, the numbers which show you which fingers to play those notes with so you can get used to playing in a correct fashion. Again, only a few dollars, something you should get. If you're just starting out, I recommend primer level or level 1. Those are the most basic. And you can also get an adult course if you're one of our older learners, and it's a little bit more advanced, so you'll move quicker. If you are one of my students, I have provided you with a Piano Lessons 1, 2, 3 handbook. Now, what this contains is not only a schedule, it also contains music theory exercises, contains finger exercises, and scales and arpeggios. Also, you should look into a theory book if you want to practice the music theory we go over in these lessons. What they do is they have different exercises which are applicable, and you fill out the worksheet according to your knowledge. Gives you a chance to rehearse what you know. Alright, so now that we've gone over those few things, and I will go in the metronome in more depth at the piano, as well as manuscript paper and Hanon exercises, we'll get into that, I want to start on Lesson 2. Now, last time we talked about staff, the staves, and we talked about treble clef, G clef. This time I want to give a formal introduction to what those are. What color do I want? We'll do white for now. All right. So first of all, I want to make a grand staff. If you remember how to do that, we need a bar line at the end, and we need a curved bracket. All right. Almost to a grand staff. Let's close off the end as well. Pardon my poor drawing. All right. So now, I want to pay specific attention to how we draw a treble clef. So, where we position a treble or G clef is the other name for a treble clef, is dependent on the staff. Now, G clef tells you what note that clef circles on the staff. So it is very important where it is located. So the first thing you want to start with is a hook. A hook that faces left. All right. You want to start this below the staff, and you want to bring the right side up above the staff. So you have a very accentuated letter J. Next, you want to curve the top, which has now been above the staff, like a cursive letter D, around and back over itself before you get back to the staff, and bring it down at an angle to the lower line of the staff. You are now going to draw a circle which goes up to the third line, but no higher. So if you notice, it goes down to the bottom line and goes up to the third line, and it circles the second line. Why is that important? Well, as you may have guessed, this second line is actually G. So why don't we highlight that all the way down? Let's see how straight of a line I can draw. That is G. We will get into more about that in a second. Why don't we label this with a G so we remember? G. Now, why don't we do the same thing for the bass clef? I'll show you how to draw it first, then we'll talk about what it means. Bass clef has two names, much like the treble or G clef. Bass clef can also be called the F clef. Reason being, on the staff it points out where the note F is. So let's draw a bass clef. The first thing you want to do is put a large dot on the fourth line of the lower staff. Next, you want to do a half heart shape up to the fifth line and curve the half heart back over and down to the bottom line. The last step is pretty easy. This is somewhat easier to draw than the treble clef, is you have two smaller dots, one in the middle of the fourth line and one in the middle of the fourth space and third space. Now if you notice, these two dots surround the fourth line. And can you guess what the fourth line might be? Hopefully you can! The fourth line is, as you might have guessed, F. Okay, so now we do know one other thing so far about music, is that the musical alphabet is A through G, and that repeats in both directions. A, B, C, D, E, F, G, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, we don't have any other letters, and then we go A, G, and it continues backwards as well. So, seeing we know the logical sequence of letters, if we know that is G, we know that the space above it must be A, the next letter in the musical alphabet, because it repeats. We know that that line must be B. We know that this line must be D. And this line must be F. And this line below G must be E. Now let me draw in the space letters as well. So, G, A, B, C, D, E, F. If you notice, going upwards, the spaces of the treble staff spell out the word face. And unfortunately, the lines are not quite so simple. That is not one of our words. Not quite a thing. But what we can do is come up with an acronym. Anything you like. We could say, every good boy deserves fudge, and there are a number of other ones out there. Whatever helps you remember the lines and spaces, use it. Similarly, if we know this is F, we know A, B, C, D, E, F, we know the space must be G. We'll stick with our color scheme. And we know this line must be A. Now, what else can we figure out? Well, I'll fill them in for you. But hopefully, you would be able to figure out all of these simply by cycling through the musical alphabet. Now, these are all the natural keys. These are not including sharps or flats or anything like that yet. We'll get to that in a later lesson. And I also wanted to mention, sometimes I'll say that we'll get to this later, and I don't always mean in the same video, but I do mean we will get to it, as in either later in the video or later in the series. So now that we have the lines and spaces of the bass clef and lines and spaces of the treble clef, we can put this to use. So first of all, we have a few acronyms. I'll give you a hint to what they are. All cows eat grass, or golden birds do fly away. And you can come up with whatever fun ones you like to help remember them, but please remember them. Now, so I'm going to put a note on each of these that we have created. I'll start over here. And I'm just drawing whole notes, although these could be half notes, they could be quarter notes, they could be eighth notes, 16th notes, 32nd notes, whatever you want, but I'm keeping them as whole notes just for simplicity. All right, so we have G, A, B, C, D, E, F, hopefully we know that one, G, A. So now, every time we've done this, we've always gone line, space, line, space, line, space, line. So we can actually have a note that lies right on top of the staff. And this, can you guess what it is if this is A? That's right. This is B. And we'll keep to our color scheme. B. Now, something we talked about in the previous lesson is middle C. So now, keeping in mind that we always go line, space, line, space, the next note would have to be on a line. But we don't have any lines. So how can we do this? Well, middle C has that line through it. This line through it is sort of like a makeshift line of a staff. It simply indicates that it is one higher than the one that doesn't have a line through it. Or you could imagine B having a line above it like that. The same line right here. So this, of course, is C. And what this is known as is a ledger line. A ledger line is a note or a line that does not actually touch the staff. So this is on. The B is actually still touching, but now the C is no longer touching the original staff. So it is a ledger line note, or a ledger space note, but we always call them ledger lines just out of practice. So I want to do the same thing for the upper line. I want to start up here, and we'll start at F, E, D, C, B, A, hopefully we know this is G, F, E. Now, if you've guessed it, just like we can put a note right on top of the staff, we can put one touching and right below. And so, if this is E, what's one letter right before E? Hopefully you've come up with it's D. Now, right after D, if we have our ledger line again, we can have middle C. Now, notice how this note, this C, is closer to this staff, and this note is closer to this staff. Even though they look different, they are actually the same note. So what you can kind of imagine is if we were to have a dotted line right down the middle of our staff, we would have three notes that sort of split up and connect these staves. So we would have B, I'll label that. We would have C, and we'll accentuate that line there. And we would have D. So because this is a grand staff, or a special type of system, we can consider one continuous graphical representation of where notes are. Now there's a systematic way. Now, I stopped there and there, but this can actually extend. We can have F, we can have E, we can have D, and we can even have C again. Or we can have G, or A, or B, or C. This keeps going, because if you notice this many notes, that's not 88 notes, and a piano has 88 notes. So if you look at your piano, I don't have the piano in focus right now, but if you look at a piano and you find middle C, like we talked about before, and you count the number of C's total, you'll notice that there's C, there's C3, C2, C1, and if you go upwards, there's C5, C6, C7, and C8. The highest note on a piano is C. And you can confirm that because if you look at the triplets right before the end of the piano, you can assume that there would be another set of twins, which are the black keys that we talked about, again, in lesson one, and the note directly to the left of that is C. Additionally, the first note, or the lowest note on the piano, is A, and it has that one black key there. Now, you heard me using a term, C4, C5, C6. Well, we actually give these notes a number. When we're playing, we don't. But if we're talking about music in general, I know, more musical jargon, but this middle C is actually C4. And no, it is not explosive, thankfully. C4. So, what can we say about that? C4, then that must mean, if we follow it down, this would be C3. And this is also a C. If you practice this, you'll get quick at reading this. This is C5. I want to use a different color for that, just so that we can see that. C3, C4, and C5. So the lowest C on your piano is C1, and the highest key on your piano, and that's when there are no more keys, no C's or any other keys, that's C8. So why do we do this? We do this so we know what note we're talking about. So if a musician says, play E3 for me, he means the E between C3 and C4. So the C is the starting point. So at C4, if we count backwards, let's start at this. This is also C4. C4, D4, E4, F4, G4, A4, B4, C5. Then we have C5, D5, E5, F5, G5, A5. Similarly, if we go below C4, we're now back into the 3 range. So we have B3, same note, A3, G3, F3, E3, D3, C3. So the C's are the markers. So if you can find the C that's directly below your note is the number marker of what note you're on. So once you get to a new C, that new number takes over, and that will continue to be the note after each pitch name until you get to the next C. So if you notice C1, the lowest C on your keyboard, there are notes before that. So what do we call those? Well, if you were to imagine that the piano extends further than it does, further than 88 keys, you would have C0. So what we actually have is A0, A-sharp 0, B0, and then C1, and then C-sharp 1, D1, D-sharp 1, E1, F1, and we'll keep going until we're up to C8, the highest note. So hopefully that clears up some confusion. Maybe it's created some confusion for some of you. This isn't super important, but it is nice to know, especially with orchestral works, or if you're working in a band and they say, I want an E3 or a G3 or a C4 or a C3, you know exactly where on the piano or in the music they're talking about. So hopefully you'll remember the name of these. We have the treble clef, or the letter G. And we have the bass clef, or the letter F. Now I'm going to erase this. If you don't have this down, pause the video now, copy it down, and then start it back up when you're done. I think this is the first time you're seeing me erase this board. Sort of funny, when I first started doing this, I didn't use a wet cloth, I used a dry cloth. And when I had gotten done doing what I was doing, I had turned around and I had seen that the entire room was covered in dust. That was not fun. But I don't do that anymore. Alright. Okay. Let me grab this chalk. Some more down. Okay. So something else I want to take a look at. So in piano, we are going to deal pretty much exclusively with treble and bass clef, or G and F clef. However, in music, there are actually more than treble and bass clef. There are actually a few more. I'm only going to mention two of them just so we're a little bit more musically literate and we're aware of their existence. So I've drawn up a staff here again. Again, if you have manuscript paper, that's very nice because you don't have to do that. So remember how the treble clef pointed to the second line, which was G, and the bass clef pointed to the fourth line, which was F. Well, we have two other clefs, and they look pretty much identical. It's a straight line, and then it's kind of like a capital letter B. And this point is the important part. I'm only going to draw this in locally, because I'll draw another one. This is a C clef. Or an alto clef, as in choral work. So we have soprano, alto, tenor, bass. So we have the C clef or alto clef. And so what this line is, if you can guess by the name C clef, this line right here is actually middle C. So it's like that space right between the treble clef and the bass clef, where it points to middle C. So then if this is C, this would be that D we talked about, this would be the B we talked about, and then we'd be into the lines of the bass clef. And so after D, we'd be into the lines of the treble clef. So why is this useful? Because it allows this line to actually go a little bit lower or higher, and lower or higher. So instead of cutting off right below the treble clef, you can actually extend in both directions a little bit more. Now we have another clef, which looks pretty much exactly the same, except we've shifted. Now, this is still a C clef, except this is now the tenor clef. And once again, the middle points out middle C. Middle C. So why is this the same thing, but it's located different, located on the staff differently? Well, if you think about it, tenors, usually males, have lower voices than altos. So what's more important to them, higher notes or lower notes? Well, lower notes, of course. So what this does is it gives them more space on the staff lower to the clef, whereas this one has more space above the clef. Hopefully that clears up some confusion. This isn't super important for piano, but it is nice to know that it exists. Okay, looking at my cue cards, I think that's where I want to stop for this lesson. Meet me over by the piano for the rest. Okay, so now that we're over at the piano, I did want to show you once more the metronome. And what we use a metronome for, as I stated earlier, is to keep a steady beat. So hopefully you can see this here. This is a standard Korg metronome. We have a power button. If we turn it on, we have, hopefully you can see that. Well, if you can't, it has a number and it has a note. And that number is the beats per minute. So if it's set to 60, that means you're going to hear 60 of these clicks per 1 minute, or one per second. Now, additionally, the presence of that quarter note means that it's counting out quarter notes. And that's where you want to keep it at. So for now, keep it at quarter notes and keep it at 60. You can change it as you progress. I'm going to set this, why not here? Okay. Something I want to show to you now is something that I use with my students, and it is called the virtuoso pianist. It sounds very, very complicated, very convoluted. All it is it's a series of musical exercises. It's actually a book of 60 exercises, split up into three sections of 20 exercises, and the first 20 are meant for beginners, second 20 for intermediate students, and the last 20 for advanced students. And the nice part about this is it's a very simple finger strengthening exercise. And the reason it's nice is because all of these patterns are exactly the same. So once you get down one pattern, you just shift it upwards and you have the next pattern. So hopefully you can see this, but if you notice these tiny little numbers right below the notes or the pitches, those are finger numbers. And in the previous lesson, we talked about having fingers 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So if it's saying to use 5, it's talking about your pinkies. If it's saying to use 4, it's talking about your ring fingers, 3, middle finger, 2, index fingers, and 1 are thumbs. So what I want to show you is this very simple Hanon exercise. Now remember our posture, we're sitting at the piano bench, we have our back straight, shoulders rolled back, feet flat on the floor. We also have our forearms parallel to the ground so that our wrists are even with the keyboard. We don't want our wrists down and we don't want our wrists up. And then we want our fingers curved at all three, 1, 2, and 3 knuckles. So we're going to place our fingers in the C octave hand position, and we went over this in the previous lesson. So if you're confused about what the C octave hand position is, please watch that lesson. Now, of all five of our fingers, 1, 2, and 3, as you might intuitively know, are our most limber. They are our most precise and most limber fingers. And then fingers 4 and 5 are naturally our weakest fingers. They're really there just for extra support. What these exercises aim to do is strengthen the hands, or both hands, evenly so that all 5 fingers on each hand, or all 10 fingers, are equally as strong as each other. So the first exercise, we're going to start in middle C, or excuse me, C octave hand position. If you recognize that exercise you started with last time, that's good. Now what we're going to do is we're going to leave our pinky of our left hand and our thumb of our right hand on C, and the rest of the fingers, we're simply going to shift up. So normally it would be C, D, E, F, G. Now it's C, E, F, G, A. Why are we doing this? We're creating a little bit of a stretch between fingers 5 and 4 of our left hand and fingers 1 and 2 of our right hand. So now the exercise goes like this. So C, E, F, G, A, G, F. Instead of playing C again, we're going to shift these fingers up to the D, D. And then we're going to play D, and we're going to shift the rest of our hand up again. So we're maintaining that hand position from the beginning, we're just shifting each time. So if you think about it, up 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, down 3, 1, 2, 3, lift and shift. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, down 3, 1, 2, 3, lift and shift. 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, lift and shift. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, lift and shift. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, lift and shift. Well, down 3, lift and shift. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, down 3, lift and shift. We're going to do that until we get to the B. So we're not going to continue up to C, we're just going to go from C up to B and end on this D. Now at this point, you should take out your handy dandy metronome, you should turn it on, and what I want is for you to start as slow as you have to. So why don't we start at 90? You'll probably want to start slower than this, but for the purpose of this video, I'm going to keep it a little faster. So now what we're going to do is we're going to give each note one click. So for each click, we're going to play a note. And it's going to sound something like this. Thank you. stop at the D. Now, as you're doing that, I want you to focus on the posture you're holding, and I want you to focus that each of the notes you play is the same volume. So you want evenness of pressure when you play the keys. You don't want to be playing with your arm, you want to be playing with your fingers. So like a typing motion, you're striking the keys with only your fingers. This isn't an arm strengthening exercise or wing. This is a finger strengthening exercise. So we're going to go from C up to B. On the D's, and now the exercise is going to switch it up. Now you should have your thumb of your left hand and your pinky of your right hand on the G's, these high G's. So now what we're going to do is we're going to stretch out the opposite parts of our hand. So now if you put your hand in sort of a C octave hand position, an octave higher than usual, we're going to take this position, we're going to press the G's and hold it, we're going to shift the rest of our hand down, right? So now we have B, C, D, E, and G, so we're skipping F. You see that? So we're stretching fingers 1 and 2 of our left hand, and fingers 4 and 5 of our right hand. So once we go up to B, and down to G, now we're going to switch to the new style. So now it's going to go down. So down 5, up 3, lift and shift, down 5, up 3, lift and shift. And again, you're going to be doing this with your metronome at whatever speed you need to start at, but each time you do it, the closer you get to perfection, up the speed just a few clicks and do it faster and faster until you get it as fast as you feel comfortable. I would say don't do it faster than 120 for now. You don't want to cause any strain or tendonitis. You want to start out simple and we'll build from there. So I'm going to play last two rounds of the upward, the ascending part of this exercise, and then I'm going to jump right into descending, as you should too. And on the A's, up to F and C. So that last part is when our right hand reaches these A's, we're going to play that last round, and instead of continuing on to G, we're just going to play the C octaves. So A, F, E, D, C, D, E, F, C. And that concludes the exercise. And actually, if you want to, when you end on C, instead of ending, you can just jump right back into the ascending part. Until you are comfortable, and keep doing it until you can get it up to a moderate speed. Right now we're pretty slow. If you keep it between 120 clicks per minute or beats per minute and 150 clicks per minute or beats per minute, that would be ideal. Then you are really strengthening your hand and gearing up for later exercises. Now these exercises are called Hanon exercises. Hopefully you can see that. They were written by a guy by the name of Hanon, H-A-N-O-N, and if you look up a PDF of this file, you should be able to print out these exercises as well. Meet me over at the board for the conclusion of this lesson. I hope you've enjoyed Lesson 2 of Piano Lessons 1 through 3 Lecture Series. This lesson has contained information about the clefs, the staff, pitch notation, as well as a very introductory piano exercise. I am Ryan Neubauer. If you would like more of these videos, please visit pianolessons123.com. You can view more of these lessons there, or you can schedule piano lessons with me. Thanks for watching.